Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 30. Sing to the Lord, you saints of His. Praise His holy name. For His anger lasts only a moment, but His favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may remain for a night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. Please stand for hymn number 362. Standing and turn to page 133 in the Book of Worship for the Liturgy for Evangelism. Holy, 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 the Lord Almighty is holy.
Thank you.
God of creation, whose love invites all people to receive the blessing reserved for us since before time began.
Grant to us the faith that each one may clearly hear your gracious call.
God of salvation, whose love encompasses all humanity, who assumed flesh and blood and died that all might live.
Give eyes of faith, Lord Jesus, that everyone may plainly see you among us.
God of inspiration, whose love initiates new ways of reaching out to all who risk believing.
Guide our lives in faith, that we may willingly become your instruments of love and
With gratitude to the Lord, we remember our rich heritage of committed servants who carried the good news to their neighbors throughout the world, who followed Jesus' command, go to all people and make them my disciples.
Thank you, eternal God, for those that have gone before us, faithful to the Great Commission. We praise you for imparting to us
with humility before the Lord, we confess our sin. When we fail to communicate Jesus' promise of new life, when we have not reached beyond ourselves with the word entrusted to us, when we retreat into comfortable sanctuaries and do not seek to be a light to the nations, when we become preoccupied with church involvement for its own sake and do not labor to proclaim salvation to the ends of the earth, when we fail to recognize that the measure of success is not only in the number of constituents, but also in the sincerity of conversion, when we are too timid or afraid to speak the gospel message to those you want to hear it, when we allow a life of ease to divert us from those who need your love through us,
forgive us, we pray.
Touch our lips with the burning coals of your forgiveness.
And purify our hearts.
The Lord, your Redeemer, says, now your guilt is gone and your sins are forgiven.
Thank you.
Throughout the ages, God's call to mission summons a response.
We affirm our heartfelt yearning to reply.
God asks, "Whom shall I send? Who will be my messenger?" God, our Redeemer, we share our longing to minister as partners, together with you and each other. Our desire is shaped by your will, our commitment molded by your covenant.
We dedicate ourselves again this day. We accept the challenge joyfully to proclaim Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord.
We covenant with you to be loving instruments of understanding and forgiveness among those to whom you send us.
We promise you to be living invitations for others to meet you as Lord and Savior.
We press on with resolve so that your word may spread rapidly and you may be glorified everywhere. We must work the works of him who sends us while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work.
We will go, send us.
Young people, come forward, please. Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. Bunch of you in the nursery. It's crowded in there today. So let's see. Anybody know who Thomas Edison is? Yes? Go ahead. Suddenly it left you, right? He made the light bulb, right. Okay, he invented a lot of other things too, as it turns out. But, you know, I always thought, in fact, not too many years ago, Ford Motor Company had an advertisement where they had a light bulb that said, Ford has a better idea, and they had this light bulb, and, you know, and a light bulb, shiny light bulb, is kind of a symbol of having this bright idea, you know, suddenly you're trying to figure something out, and oh, wow, suddenly you see the light, and the light bulb comes on in your head, and you understand. And so somehow I always equated that with Thomas Edison. I thought he was this brilliant guy who all of a sudden one day went, oh, I can build a light bulb, and threw this light bulb together, and boom, we had a light bulb. Turns out Edison tried 800 times. He built 800 light bulbs that didn't work before he finally came up with one that worked. It turns out it's that way with a lot of good inventors. Some of them have brilliant ideas that just come to them all of a sudden when the light bulb comes on, but others just have to plug away at it and learn and learn and learn until finally it works. And we run across those stories in the Bible, too, of sometimes people just understand what Jesus is all about immediately, and others, it takes them a long time and they have to work it out. Our story today, our scripture story today, is about Paul, who saw a great light And he saw Jesus in that light, and that was his moment of conversion. It happened just like that. But not all of us get to do that. For some of us, we have to work it out for a long time. We learn from our parents and from teachers, and we have various experiences, and eventually we begin to understand something about our Christian faith. So it works both ways, and we need to accept the fact that sometimes the light bulb just doesn't come on, that some people have to work at it for a long time. So let's have a moment of prayer before you leave. Gracious Lord, as we live our Christian faith and as we try to explain that faith to other people, we would ask that you give us the strength and understanding to see that not everyone instantly gets it, that some people have to work at it, and that sometimes that we have to work at it, and that the light bulb doesn't come on and we don't see right away. So I'd ask that you be with these young people, that you grant them the strength and the wisdom to continue to seek out a relationship with you and to grow in their faith. We ask your blessing on them, their families, and on this church family. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming up. the opportunity during this time before the offering to say something about that it's just as important to share your talents as it is your wealth, and emphasize that giving is not just in the amount of money that you put in the plate, but in the things that you do for our community and for the congregation and for the church as a whole. So in that spirit, I would like to take the opportunity to thank those who came out for spring cleaning yesterday. We had a smaller group than last year, but a very energetic group, and they took everything out of the kitchen cabinets, washed the cabinets, washed all the dishes, sanitized all the dishes. They trimmed outside. You'll notice that the flowers are all trimmed and things are ready to go for springtime. Hopefully it's coming. And we did manage to injure the senior pastor on the way, but we got a lot of work done. Those places that are hard to reach were all cleaned and dusted, and I was proud of them. They did a lot of really good work. So thank you to all of you who were here. It's really appreciated. Let us take this time to worship our Lord with our tithes and our offerings. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we bring you these gifts of thanksgiving, and we ask that you would give us the wisdom to use them to do your good work in our world, that you would help us to see the light and to understand those things that you would have us do. We would ask today that you be with Reverend Knapp and you help him to get relief from his back pain and healing, and we ask you to be with him during his surgery on Monday. We'd also ask that you be with Jim Sarkis and his family as he recovers from a hospital stay. We'd ask that you be with Dolores Evenson and June Larson as they undergo rehab in the nursing facility in town, and also that you continue to grant healing and comfort to Bev Peterson as she battles her cancer and looks for healing and rehab there. We'd ask you to be with all who are suffering or who have suffered loss, that you bring healing and peace to all people, and that you bring peace and joy to our world. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Today's scripture reading comes from Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do."
Barb and I happened to watch a TV show Friday night that we had recorded at some point back in time. I don't remember the channel, but the show was from a series titled Looking for God, which featured Morgan Freeman as the narrator. And the episode we watched was called Beyond Death. Now, as it turns out, it's not really all that great a series, but the topic seemed really interesting, and even listening to Morgan Freeman read the telephone book would be worth an hour, you know, so we stuck with it for a little while. The episode began with Freeman interviewing a man who had drowned. This man was a commercial fisherman on a boat out in the Pacific Ocean, and they got caught in a huge storm. The boat was swamped, and he was thrown overboard into 30-foot seas. He doesn't know how deep those turbulent waves took him, but he remembers finally being unable to hold his breath any longer and just giving up and inhaling a mouthful of seawater. And he said it was a particularly violent way to die. He then, at some point, he said, saw a bright light that began in the distance but soon took over his whole consciousness. And from his description, I think it's pretty fair to say that he felt as much as he saw this light. It was multicolored, and it moved, and finally just took over his entire being. Then he heard or felt a voice say, "It's not your time." The next thing he remembered was being hit by a piece of debris in the sea, rain around his stomach, and having the seawater forcefully expelled from his lungs and then being dragged aboard a lifeboat. His crewmates estimated that he was underwater for about 15 to 20 minutes. He says that he's convinced that he was dead and that the light he saw was God. He's convinced now that after death, there is some kind of existence. Now, I have to tell you, I'm a skeptic about such stories. I'm at least a bit of a skeptic. Many have proven over the years to have been hoaxes, and many of them can be explained away either by scientific fact or by some kind of rationalization. And there's always those that seem to be tied to some kind of commercial or economic gain. But, and here's the problem, I have known a fair number of people who have had near-death experiences, some who have even been declared dead, who have told me after the fact, after they came back, that they experienced much the same thing. They saw a light or a pathway of light, or light took over everything, and it was beautiful and it was peaceful. And they saw loved ones who had passed away before them, or they saw Jesus in that light. Several of them have told me they heard a voice telling them to go back because it was not their time. Now, these are people that I know, and people who I trust to tell the truth. Rational folks. A couple of them are even relatives of members of this congregation. And this brings this whole idea of this experience of God or Jesus in this incredible way, the great light and the voice, it brings that whole thing a lot more credibility, and it makes it harder to just disregard it as so much spiritual gobbledygook. The man who drowned in the boat said he did not know if the light and the voice was Jesus. He just knew it was God, and so he was keeping an open mind about everything else. Others who have that experience are sure that they saw Jesus in this great light experience. The Apostle Paul, in the story that we just read, did not apparently have a near-death experience, but he was stricken on the road to Damascus, as it was explained in our text today. Now, Paul knew something about religious experiences and the coming of God and a blinding light. He was a devout and a learned Jew. He knew that God came to Moses and to Ezekiel and to Daniel and to others in bright, bright light. Paul, just like our drowned man, didn't recognize Jesus at first. He cried out, "Who are you, Lord?" And Jesus told him, "I am the one who you are persecuting. I'm Jesus." As can be expected, this close encounter with Jesus transformed Paul from a persecutor of Jesus' followers to a follower himself. And he, in fact, becomes perhaps the most important convert to Christianity ever, because it's Paul who spread Christianity to the Gentiles of Asia Minor and to Rome. And it's Paul who wrote in his letters much of what we now call the New Testament. It is important to note that Paul was not converted by a persuasive preacher or through the nurture of Christian parents. Paul, rather, became a Christian through his experience of the risen Lord. We use this expression lightly sometimes. I think, I saw the light, meaning that some experience made you understand some basic truth. I used to think the babies came from storks. But when I was 6 years old, my aunt had a baby, and suddenly I saw the light. Babies come from mothers. As we get older, we see more light, and we begin to take things more seriously. I used to think that babies were made by people and came from mothers, but I saw the light. Now I realize they are created by and they come from God. So let's take it seriously for a moment. When did you see the light? When did you first realize that Jesus Christ is our living Lord and Savior, is in fact God? Or are you still searching for that light? Obviously, it's okay with God if you are searching. Just look what he did for Paul. I think it's fair to say, though, that if you stop searching and you deny that there is any light and you choose to live in darkness, well, then you might have a problem. But I have to confess, I don't know, and I'm not sure how Jesus works all that out with people. But I do know that Jesus calls people to him. He called Paul, he called many others, and he called me. I also know that Paul didn't just change somehow overnight. He believed immediately upon experiencing Jesus, but he changed over a period of time, as is explained in the book of Acts and in Paul's letters. So if God has called you, if you are not still searching, but you believe, then how has your experience of Jesus changed your life? A lady named Kathleen Norris has written many good books. One that I really liked is called Dakota, A Spiritual Geography. I like it, I think, because the Dakotas had a lot to do with my own spiritual growth and because she explains it so well. In one memorable scene, she describes this group of farmers who are standing around an open grave after a funeral with their heads bowed, and they appear to be talking to each other. And so she kind of eases over there to hear what it is. She's new to the community, and she wants to hear what it is they're having to say that seems so serious. She wants to hear their prayer, maybe. And so she gets over close to them, and she figures out that what they are doing is pointing down and discussing where the frost line reached that winter. She also wrote a really good book called The Cloister Walk, in which she, in really magical prose, writes about her own growth, about how knowing Jesus changed her life. In the very beginning of the book, she writes, "For years, early morning was a time I dreaded. In the process of waking up, my mind would run with panic. All the worries of the previous day would still be with me, spinning around with old regrets as well as fears for the future. I don't know how or when the change came, but now when I emerge from night, it is with more hope than fear. I try to get outside as early as possible so that I can look for signs of first light, the faint, muddy red of dawn. What changed for Kathleen Norris was getting up early and watching the sun come up, and then practicing morning meditations, liturgies, and prayers. And she learned to do this when she was a guest at an abbey in North Dakota. Now, you can understand this as her actual physical and spiritual benefit of getting up early and praying, or you can see it as sort of a metaphor for her entire life. She began to look for the light of Jesus, and then she began to put her beliefs into practice. When was the last time you went out and saw the sunrise? Did you pray? So Paul was converted in a flash of light and changed from a persecutor of Christians to a leader of the Christian church. Good, so far as it goes. Conversion and change are important, but they are really only a means to an end, because it didn't stop there for Paul. Jesus had a mission for him, a calling for him. He was to be the one who would carry the gospel of Jesus to the world well beyond Palestine. Jesus told him to go into the city, where he will be told what he must do. Paul was not told just to believe and to change his ways. He was told that Jesus had a specific work for him to do. So, you have seen the light. You are a believer. Maybe you have even changed your behavior. So now, what is Jesus calling you to do? Not what you think you might like to do for Jesus. This is not a smorgasbord where you just walk by and you get to pick and choose. Each of us has a calling, a specific thing or things that we must do. I heard a lady once who was retiring from 30 years of Christian education respond to the question, what are you going to do in your retirement? What she said was she was going to go start an orphanage, hopefully a series of orphanages and schools in Africa. She was 70, maybe. Upon hearing the audible gasp from the audience, she turned and said with a sparkle in her eye, it doesn't say in my Bible that you get to retire from doing God's work. So I have looked it up, and I haven't been able to find where it says you get to retire from doing God's work either. She was correct. When God has nothing left for you, it appears that he will call you home. The guy in Morgan Freeman's TV show thought he was at peace. He had seen something he thought proved that there was life after death, and that was all he needed to know. That is all that concerned him. He believed, and everything was going to be okay after he was dead. He was no longer afraid of death. He had seen the light, and nothing else mattered. Well, all that is good as far as it goes, and Christians certainly should, in their faith, have great hope that eternal life. And we should not fear death. Jesus has conquered death for us. It is an amazing thing. But it is not all. God has much for you to do. You can tell me that you are too busy or too tired or lacking in talent, and I will be sympathetic toward you, because that is part of my calling, to be sympathetic. But consider perhaps how sympathetic Jesus might be when you do not do the thing that he said you must do. God is in this holy place of worship, and you will find him here whenever you come here. You can see, feel, and hear the light. But we cannot just leave God here. We need to get up and watch the sunrise each day. We need to pray. We need to go out into the city, and there it is that we will be told what we must do. Amen. Please stand for hymn number 768. Go now into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering and honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you both now and forever.